Yeah, I think there. I think that is an element. You know, people are also recognizing that the Fed is so far behind the curve, given what we're seeing generally in a lot of commodity prices across the board. And I think the most fundamental, important factor is that, you know, people are recognizing how cheap gold and silver are. I mean, we've seen prices of everything soaring. You know, stock markets are at record highs again today. You know, some of the favorite stocks are being bid up toward a trillion market cap. And, you know, here we have gold and silver at bargain basement prices. So I think you're seeing a lot of money coming out of other sectors, and it's going to be going into gold and silver. But, you know, more importantly, I've been making the case here that with the option expiry, which started today, I think we're going to see a short squeeze developing in gold and silver, for that matter, that's probably started from the April low and is going to carry for several months going forward. That's going to bring about much higher prices for the simple reason that there's so much paper out there and relatively little physical metal.
And you see this primarily as being something that's coming out of the COMEX and the, you know, in the silver market, we've seen some pretty interesting open interest trends. You know, people who are going long continue to go long. And at the same time, the opposite side of that trade is, you know, bullion banks, and they're digging in their heels. So it's kind of a pretty strong standoff.
Yeah, it is a strong standoff. But, you know, when you're short, there are two things to keep in mind. If the price goes up when you're short, you know, the central banks can, and if you have the central banks are the short, they can just print more money and, you know, pay that money to the long. But what I'm talking about is a short squeeze that's driven by longs who want physical metal and aren't necessarily looking for just a short-term paper trading profit. And that's where I think that's where we should all be focusing on. And in this regard, I was very pleased to see that this morning in New York, they could not get gold back below 1250. So a lot of the options above 1250 will be, you know, off in the money, which is sort of interesting because when you're that close to a price, in the past they tried to push it below key levels in order to make those options go off the board worthless. So that I think was very interesting. And the other thing that I've noticed is that exchange for futures for physical activities picked up. 15,000 gold contracts were reported yesterday on the preliminary data, which is huge. I think that's a record. I don't think I've seen that before. So what the shorts are doing is trying to take the demand for physical metal off the COMEX and put it into the over-the-counter market. And my guess is that what they're doing is giving prices that are attractive to those longs above the COMEX forward price in order to entice those longs to stay with paper for a little bit longer and relieving the pressure of having to deliver physical metal to those longs. So I'm still of the view that we're at the very beginning of a demand for physical metal, both gold and silver, that's going to send the prices of both metals much, much higher over the months, weeks and months ahead.
Do you see indications in the LBMA too of tightness?
Yeah, I do. You know, we're trading in backwardation. The spot price here is the cash price here is above the June delivery, and June delivery is only a few days away. So again, this is an indication that, you know, markets are very, very tight. And you sort of see the flows going around, and there is not a lot of metal available if you want to be purchasing in any kind of a size. And that's why you're seeing this, I think, people going to the futures market and being rolled into the exchange for physicals. It's hard to say because all of these contracts are basically private contracts. They're going off exchange, so there's no visibility. But you know, that's the way the shorts want it. They don't want the exposure about how little physical metal is available relative to the total size of paper commitments out there to actually deliver physical metal. And again, I'm talking about both gold and silver.
What's been your experience with your desk at Gold Money? You see trends within the marketplace. Do you see anything too that gives you further confidence that what's going on in the COMEX and paper markets in general is something that you see as well being expressed through Gold Money?
Well, I'm not specifically talking about gold money or gold money flows because I don't really, sure. You know, I'm not involved in the day-to-day in gold money. I'm a director of the company, but I don't get involved in the day-to-day stuff. These are from, you know, my own sources outside of gold money, I would say. But yeah, you know, what it is, it's a question of, or an effort to put together lots of bits and pieces of anecdotal evidence. It's like putting together a crossword puzzle, or any, you know, a puzzle of a picture, and you're putting in little pieces to the puzzle and trying to figure out what the picture's like. And looking at backwardation, looking at gold flows, what I hear from colleagues, you know, delivery issues, all of these together suggest to me that metal is very tight. And you even see it to a certain extent if you read between the lines of the LBMA announcements. There was an announcement that came out a couple weeks ago from the LBA that they're going to be reporting the weight of gold in the London LBMA vaults. But the curious thing was that they said that they won't be reporting the gold that's available in other vaults nearby in Europe. But you know, why would we even care about the other gold available in Europe unless they were worried about not having enough gold here in London because of the tightness of the metal? So again, you're reading between the lines, putting little bits and pieces of the puzzle together. It suggests to me that, based on my experience, and I mean, I could be wrong. I've been wrong before, but I have a pretty good sense of it this time. My thinking is that we are in the beginning of what's going to be a big short squeeze in the metals. I hesitate to compare it to what's going on in the cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin, but I can't move away from that, because the way cryptocurrencies are trading, and the one I follow most closely is Bitcoin, that's the way commodities used to trade back in the 1970s, before governments started getting involved with all of the heavy-handed intervention and, you know, ham-fisted interventions that have basically mucked up the markets. Bitcoin is still basically a free market. And so to see it go the way it has when in response to demand is sort of refreshing. It brings back memories of what the 1970s were like. And I sort of think that, you know, that's maybe not that quite a dramatic of an increase, but, you know, dramatic in the sense that when it keeps going up, it's going to keep going up for a period of time. And I'm talking about months here. I'm not talking about days. That's what I'm expecting for the precious metals as the squeeze takes hold as we get through this option expiry period.
A lot of people have been looking at Bitcoin and Ethereum and the performance that cryptos have been doing, and they're contemplating the idea of them, that is actually taking attention away from precious metals. I've been a little bemused by that, because the entire market capitalization, if you could call it that, of all of the Bitcoin and other Ethereum and other coins outstanding, I don't know, remember off the top of my head where it is, but it's like $30 billion or so. Grand scheme of things, that's pretty small compared to gold by itself.
Yeah, that's true. On a relative basis, you know, they're tiny compared to gold. And that's why, to a certain extent, you see the volatility that you're seeing in sure. these currencies, you know, relative to the demand. But I've been following, and I've been tweeting occasionally about Bitcoin. I've been bullish on it and I continue to be bullish on it. But my last tweet, as I recall, was that don't forget to sell your Bitcoin and buy gold and silver later this year. Because I still think there's a lot left on the upside for Bitcoin. I think that's probably still good advice. I think we're going to go a lot higher. But when we do get, you know, at some extreme level and the market cap is much bigger than it is now, then, you know, get out of Bitcoin and time to go back into the precious metals, because the precious metals will be unbelievably cheap relative to an overvalued Bitcoin.
Kind of a more intermediate term to long term, James. What's it going to take to see gold and silver even to challenge their highs back from, what, 2010, 2011, when we saw gold up around 1900, silver close to $50? I mean, there's a lot of technical levels that are going to need to be overcome, especially in silver. In the physical market, there's going to be a lot of selling once silver passes 30. And then, I mean, all the people that bought from 40 to 50, there's going to be a lot of selling back into the market. That's going to need to be worked through before new nominal highs are taken out. And really the same thing in gold. I think a lot of metal would come back into the market around 1600 to the 1650 level, as well as when you got higher towards 1900. So kind of more of an intermediate to long-term take. What's your perspective on that?
Well, even if there's metal coming back on the market, it's relatively small compared to all of the paper out there and all of the representations of ability to deliver metal when, you know, there isn't the ability to deliver metal. So, you know, the imbalance between actual physical metal and representations for that is huge, and it's going to remain huge for some time. Then there's all of the new paper being created by central banks all around the world that's debasing national currencies, which is making, you know, gold even more and more attractive. But we have to remember here, John, that the low in gold was December of 2015. The low in December 2016 was above that December 2015 low. And the recent low that we just saw in gold was above the December 16 low. So we're actually, you know, into an uptrend. And this is the way bull markets get started. You know, people aren't paying attention to what's been happening over the last year and a half or last couple of years. They're still focused on, well, gosh, you know, we declined from 19 down to 1050, and lose sight of what's building. But so bull markets get started in this way. Gold and silver aren't getting the attention that they should be getting as undervalued assets, but the smart money is going into both of these markets. And when it comes to both gold and silver, the smart money is moving into physical metal. It's not moving into paper representations of metal.
I know that you've been following over the years the, you know, trends of refineries in Switzerland running 24/7, 365 days a year, and flows that are moving into China, and China's voracious appetite for gold, and increasingly so, even silver, in India as well, is coming back online too. When you think of, and when you look at the question of the, putting together the pieces of the puzzle to see where we are with physical demand and the tightness in the market, what do you see now as far, and what are you hearing from your contacts as far as the 400-ounce bar market and movements to Switzerland and conversion to kilo bars, and then the whole scramble to deal with that, siphoning away from the West, gold that's moving east?
Yeah, you know, that's really an interesting question because it really highlights a major trend that's been underway here. You know, there are basically three types of fabricated bars when it comes to gold. You have the 400-ounce bar, which is the historical standard, and it varies in weight, but approximately 400. There's a maximum and a minimum, but it averages around 400. Then there's the 100-ounce COMEX bar, which is only pretty much unique to COMEX and the United States. And then you have the kilo bar, which is approximately 31.134 ounces of troy avoirdupar. So historically, the LBMA delivery bar, the 400-ounce bar, was the important one. But the trend away from that is increasing, and the international standard has been moving and continues to move toward the kilo bar standard. So a lot of old bars continue to be melted down and moved from west to east. And I think that trend is going to continue as more and more metal gets soaked up by the private market and the central banks become less and less important. Remember, gold gets produced every day. There's approximately 8 tons of it that's produced every day. And every 50 years, the total above ground stock in the world doubles. Now, over the last 50 years, central banks really haven't changed the gold they supposedly own. In fact, they actually own a lot less because they've loaned a lot of that out and probably can't really expect to get much of that back simply because of the tightness in the market. But the point I'm making is that relative to the total above ground stock of gold, central banks have a declining percentage, and therefore they're becoming less influential. What's becoming influential in the worldwide demand for gold is the individual and the institutions representing individuals, not central banks. And these individuals and institutions are increasingly demanding kilo bars. So the old LBMA 400-ounce bar is probably going to become as insignificant as the 100-ounce COMEX bar is within, say, the next 5 to 10 years, if not sooner.
I'm curious, too, about your understanding of what's going on with the LBMA. They're facing a lot more competition. We've seen a lot more discussion and, in fact, exchanges being launched. The Shanghai Exchange now in China is quite substantial. And the center of gravity even of the price discovery mechanism in exchanges has begun to shift eastward. And those of us in the precious metals industry are looking at that with great anticipation, given the history of, shall we say, questionable price discovery out of COMEX and the LBMA. And I'm curious to know what you think about those trends and how the LBMA, has, in particular, has been trying to deal with competition and dealing with the Hong Kong Exchange is taking a direct stake within the LBMA, the trading system, and new exchanges as well, too. Do you see them actually beginning to have a significant impact on price discovery?
Yeah. Asia definitely is having a big impact on price discovery. And I think it's quite clear, to market participants that a lot of the power, the pricing power has been, that previously had been in Europe, has been eroding away. And I think it's to a large extent, a couple of reasons. First of all, there's a lot of wealth created in Asia, and gold goes to where the wealth is being created. So a lot of gold has been flowing to Asia for that reason, and therefore it's logical that price discovery would flow to Asia too. But I think another important reason is that the banks have shot themselves in the foot, by being so dishonest in so many respects. You know, we've seen all of the banks paying billions and billions and billions of dollars and euros and pounds of fines because of illegal, if not criminal, activities in the past. And, you know, in that kind of environment, if a bank gets involved in criminal activity or illegal activity, are you going to want to deal with them? Are you going to trust them? Or are you going to, move your business elsewhere? So there's a lot of money that's moved away from the West and the Western banking system to other alternatives. And, if you're living in Asia, why do you want to work? Why do you want to deal in London anyway? You're going to want to deal in Singapore, Hong Kong, Shanghai, and places like that. The only negative is that a lot of that Chinese trading is, and the reason why you're seeing these premiums on the yuan, gold price compared to the dollar gold price in Asia, is because the yuan is not a freely exchanged currency yet. But if the government there continues to loosen up the various controls and restrictions, I think Asia is going to have even a bigger impact on price discovery for the precious metals. It seems to me inevitable, unless the West changes its ways, and I don't see any indication of that happening. The West continues to downplay the role of gold rather than accepting it for its 5,000 years of history and as a solution to today's problems, including where we are in today's credit cycle.
So in the big picture, when we look at how things are going to evolve and we have a banking system, particularly in Europe, that's a little bit wobbly and Italian banks still very, very weak and economic nationalism trends, even though the French election went the way of pro-European interests, the whole longer-term picture for the European Union banking system integration as well is a little shaky. And people have taken an interest in gold all the more so in the last couple of years because of these reasons. I'm curious to know what you think. With you having spending a lot of time in Europe, where do you think those trends are after the French election and with Brexit and an ongoing process, the Italian elections coming up in the summer? Do you think that these particular dynamics in Europe are going to play a role in the precious metals in this year and in years going forward?
Yeah, I do, and I think they have been playing a role. Greece is on the ropes again. I thought they were safe 7 times already. And that doesn't even mention, as you said, the Italian banks, which, they've got severe problems. But, the banking problems throughout Europe are quite severe. And that creates uncertainty in the minds of people. When you have uncertainty, you want to go to a safe haven. Gold is a safe haven when you own physical metal because there is no counterparty risk, as we all know. But there's a bigger issue that the EU itself, in my view, is a dysfunctional institution. There are 10,000 bureaucrats in Brussels who make more money than the British Prime Minister. That's one of the things that I think upset a lot of, British voters when they voted for Brexit. So, Brexit is more than a shot across the bow. I think it's bringing down the ramparts and storming the castle. I think the EU's life is probably going to be limited. And you know, given the quality of the leadership we're seeing there at the moment in the EU, they seem to be moving further and further in the wrong direction rather than the right direction. You know, they're trying to circle the wagons rather than trying to solve the problems.
James, anything else you want to discuss or let our listeners know here before we wrap the show up?
Well, I think I've already made the major points. You know, the distinction between owning physical versus owning paper representations. And, you know, when you own physical, there are only two ways to do that. You buy it and store it yourself, or you buy it and have someone store it for you, which is, you know, what we do in gold money. And if you choose that storage alternative, actually, I recommend both, of course, but if you do choose the storage alternative to have professional storage, make sure, you know, you have the governance procedures in place, you know, the audits, the insurance, and all the things that, you know, we do at Gold Money. I think that's the key element, own physical, not paper. But the other thing is that, you know, gold and silver are undervalued here. They're very, very cheap. And as you guys know, what I've been recommending since starting Gold Money back in 17 years ago, 2001, that what you really want to do is have a dollar cost averaging plan. You know, if you want to save $100 every month, don't put it in a bank account, because at the end of the year, that $100, even if you earn some interest on it, is going to be worth less because of inflation and loss of purchasing power. Put it into physical metal. And that's the way you should be saving, you know, accumulating gold, accumulating silver. And over a long haul, over the long term, you're going to be happy to have that rainy day money accumulated that way, because you're preserving purchasing power, and you're preserving purchasing power outside the banking system. The banking system worldwide still remains very vulnerable. And if you can recall what we went through in 2008, I expect, you know, the next credit cycle, because these things repeat. If you read monetary history, you know, every several years there's been crises. You know, in my lifetime, I'm 70 years old. I saw a couple of them in the 1960s, 1973, 1978. Chicago, Continental Illinois in Chicago went bankrupt in 1983. Then there were a couple of Texas banks that went bankrupt after that. Then the Savings and Loan Associations went bankrupt in the late 1990s. Then you had Citibank on the ropes in late 1980s. Then you had Citibank on the ropes in the early 1990s. And it goes on and on. We had 2008. There's going to be another crisis in the credit cycle. It may be next year. It may be next week. It may be still a couple more years down the road. But when that comes, you're going to want to have certainty with regard to your assets. And the only way you can have certainty with regard to assets is when you own tangible things, things that have value, things that have value because they're useful to you. And, you know, gold and silver is useful as money, preserving purchasing power. A house is useful to you because that's where you provides you your shelter. And even certain shares of companies can be useful to you if those shares are, you know, properly valued, and if they in turn represent tangible assets. And I'm not talking about financial stocks. I'm obviously talking about things like agribusinesses and mining companies, companies that own things. What you want to stay away from are the counterparty risk issues, you know, bank deposits, insurance commitments, things denominated in the currencies, because the currencies and the banking system that supports them are going to be in trouble the next credit cycle, just like they were back in 2008. So I think, you know, I like to always recommend, you know, be cautious. And one of the best ways to be cautious is to think about owning things rather than owning promises.
Certainly excellent advice for any era, but particularly with the state of the modern banking system, it really was never, as you alluded to, another fixed after 2008. It was just all the debt and corruption in the banking system was just papered over.
Yeah, and it all came together at the same time, and it happened relatively quickly. And I'm sort of wondering, I don't know if you've been following the events in Canada, but, you know, the Canadian real estate market appears to have finally topped out. There's been a couple of banking-related problems in Canada on mortgage lenders, I should say, rather than mortgage lending banks, rather than commercial banks. And the way 2008 started, it didn't actually start in 2008. It started in August of 2007 when Northern Rock, which was a British bank, went belly up. And then in early 2008, Bear Stearns, you know, went belly up. And then it really got serious in September 2008 when Lehman Brothers went belly up. So, you know, if these problems in Canada are the shot across the bow, then it might unfold over the next, you know, year to 14, 15, 16 months, the next credit cycle that we've been talking about. But, you know, we just can't predict the future, John. We just have to take it day by day, week by week, and have a strategy to protect yourself come what may.
I mean, those markets are certainly very telling. The real estate market is a pretty clear indication of the degree of bubbles that we have seen blown by the central bankers putting in an enormous amount of liquidity precisely to paper over the last bubble. I mean, we keep going through these boom-bust bubble cycles that crash that are only fixed with, or fixed in quotation marks, with yet another bigger bubble being blown by central planners, by central banks. And
but, you know, Eric, last time it was the governments that bailed out all of the big banks that were essentially bankrupt in 2008. This time around, who's going to bail out the government? There's nobody left. Yeah, there's nobody
and
left.
The central banks, too. I mean, their balance sheets are just ginormous.
Yeah, so it's just going to be, you know, what we've seen throughout monetary history many, many times. They just print more currency, and the currency loses value, and it loses dramatically. It's going to be like, you know, what happened in Venezuela or Zimbabwe, but those collapses occurred relatively quickly. So you don't understand necessarily what's happening with the dollar because the collapse is occurring over a longer period of time. But what I'm suspecting will happen when we have this next credit cycle is we're going to see a lot of speed that we haven't seen in the past, speed where the dollar and the other fiat currencies of countries around the world lose value very, very rapidly. And, you know, gold and silver will do particularly well in those environments of preserving everybody's purchasing power.
Hopefully we won't have the socialistic responses that Venezuela's had, and it's turned a horrible situation into a nightmare down there right now.
Yeah, well, it was the socialism that got them on the wrong road in the first place. And, you know, it's amazing, you know, how people fall for these fake promises. I love Margaret Thatcher's quote about socialism. She said, the problem with socialism is that you eventually run out of other people's money. And that's what the socialists do. You know, they take from people who are producers and give it away and keep a lot of it themselves. And ultimately, that destroys the economy. And it's unfortunate, but it repeats time and again. And, you know, people have to basically prepare for